think you're up for the fourth reading. Everybody's getting their money worth today. No one's going home wishing they had more scripture.
They had the long rope with sleeves taken to their father, and they said, "This we found. See now whether it is your son's robe or not." He recognized it and said, "It is my son's robe. A wild animal has devoured him. Joseph is without doubt torn to pieces." Then Jacob tore his garments and put sackcloth on his loins and mourned for his son for many days. All his sons and all his daughters sought to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted and said, "No, I shall go down to Sheol to my son, mourning." Thus his father bewailed him.
Amen. Brothers took it from him and sold him into slavery. He was dethroned, and it symbolized death. And now it is used to deceive Jacob, who deceived his own father into giving Jacob Esau's blessing. And those patterns repeat generation after generation. The robe began in deep love. Then it was torn in deep hate. And now it is the main tool for a deep deception. Their brothers know Joseph isn't dead, but they let their father's heart break and let him grieve and mourn Joseph's loss. Joseph is lost, or at least Jacob thinks so, but Jacob, the father, was a dreamer too. And Joseph, the son, was the way that Jacob's dream might be fulfilled. So Jacob is also mourning the loss of the dream. Jacob saw Joseph as the one to carry that dream forward. He was the one through whom God's promise to Abraham and Isaac and to Jacob himself was supposed to flow into the future. The dream was so large. Not just a family, but a nation. Not just sibling relationships, but political power. The dream was so large and so precarious and balanced on the shoulders of a 17-year-old just coming into his full self as an adult. No wonder something that big and that precarious ended in tragedy. For the nation of Israel, balanced between Mesopotamia and Egypt, between the sea and the desert, tragedy is the unsurprising ending. They lived a life apart. Their life was formed through the lives of Abraham and Sarah, Isaac and Rebekah, Jacob and Rachel and Leah. God was trying to find a way to keep humanity on the path that God had laid out, and after several false starts, Adam and Eve, Noah, the entire building crew at the Tower of Babel. God had chosen one family and asked that family to live in a way that set them apart from their neighbors. But precarious and big dreams are not likely to work out. They are more likely to end in grief and mourning. And no one understood that better than Israel. And yet, that's not how the chapter ends. So as I come to our time of announcements, we see, are there questions from this morning's service so far? We have one more passage, but I'm reading. Questions? So Joseph is an interpreter of dreams. Like the dreams that you have at night in your own bed. Do you think that dreams are still a way that God communicates with us? Yes or no? Why or why not?
Yes.
Got a couple of yeses. Why? I mean, my dreams? I hope God is not communicating with me. Because
my dreams are just perfect. Yeah. No, nothing bad.
I don't know. I think dreams are just another form of communication and connection to faith.
Sure.
In some ways.
All right.
Good or bad.
All right. Any no's? I'm always worried that my dreams are just me talking to myself, not anything else, anything else. It's 32, but whatever. The one where he meets his wives and he gets married. Jacob gets married. Leah has five sons, boom, 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 boom. And then she becomes barren. I don't know how you become barren when you've had five sons, but there you go. She has five sons. Then the two serving maids get involved, and they have two sons each, I think. And finally, Rachel has her children. And somewhere in there, Leah has more children. So it's not so much that it's like I have an aunt who's 4 years older than I am. So it's not like there's a huge gap in the family. It's just that there were so many single kids that it just took a while to get to number 12. Joseph is number 11. So it's kind of that, but then again, there were four moms working at the same time. So there you go. But it was definitely the older sons were, you know, not a full generation older than he was, but there's plenty of time between the oldest and him.
I have a question.
Yes.
Were any of the wives involved in having opinions about Joseph and his brothers? Do we know any of that?
We don't. If you go back to that same chapter where they're getting born, the first five sons of Leah all have names like, "He'll regret ignoring me." Jealousy is one of the kids' names. Like, there's not a lot of happiness for Leah, which I understand, given her story. Of all the people in this story, I would think Jacob would understand what it is like to have a parent who plays favorites, because Isaac loved Esau way more than he loved Jacob. And yet there's that pattern repeating again. How much the moms get involved, we don't get a lot of scripture from the moms. But that we do see, one, we see them and they have names, which for scripture is pretty good. And we do get that they do speak. We do hear their voices. But no one is saying he shouldn't love Joseph the best. Answer.
What is the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars?
The sun, the moon, and the stars.
11 stars.
11 stars. So there are 12 brothers, 12 tribes of Israel. So if there are 11 stars, that's everybody but Joseph and his version of how the story gets told. Sun and the moon is his mom. They all have the same dad. It's his mom. So that's how they're interpreting that. Moon is supposed to be feminine, sun is supposed to be masculine. So there wasn't any, Jacob wasn't surprised that he, as the son, was supposed to bow down to his. The thing that was surprising was that he, but the dream was that the father would bow down to the son. That was a little shocking. Sorry, say it again without the motorcycle. So it's very unclear. The way it's positioned, and this may be the stories that are stacking up on top of each other not quite right, The way the edited version goes, Rachel has two sons, Joseph and Benjamin. And Benjamin is definitely the youngest. From the way this story is written, Joseph is the youngest, so you just sort of assume that Benjamin hasn't appeared yet. But then it says the 11 stars, which implies that he has. So that's one of the places where those scenes and the stories aren't quite working out correctly. And it will be more of an issue later, because then you have to do the whole thing when they're in Egypt, which we'll do next week, about, oh, go get the son, and he's our father's favorite, we can't possibly bring him back, and that whole, all that drama only works if Benjamin is born as the youngest and Rachel has died. So we see the story eventually. Basically, at this time in Israel, there are two primary kingdoms, the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom, and they're going to consolidate into one nation, but they have two very different story traditions. So what we're getting is this battle between the northern version and the southern version, and the priests are trying to get them to hold together, and they really don't. But it's better than, there's one place where they go to fight in a battle, and so they pick up their sword in one hand, and their lamp in the other hand, and their flail in their other hand.
Okay.
It's like, okay, that's tricky. But by gosh, we're not going to lose anything. We're just bolting it all together.
Can I just follow up on this question? Joseph knows about Benjamin.
I think Joseph, in this part of the passage, the only place where I can say definitely Joseph knows about Benjamin is the 11 stars.
He gets to Egypt, and that's the challenge.
It's sort of this. There's different meaning you could read into it if it is indeed the Ishmaelites who take Joseph to Egypt, right? That's the family betrayal story. But if it's the Midianites who take Joseph to Egypt, then that's the redemption story that's beginning to play out. So there are places where the way they put these scenes together, these stories together, takes you down different paths. So whether Joseph knows about Benjamin or not is definitely a go this way or go that way kind of story fork. So you're absolutely right. That's why I lifted it up today, because it can get really confusing. Right, next week, worship at the lake. You can come here, but you won't find anyone. It's in your bulletin, it's in the cover letter, but I just want to flag it so that we are somewhere in the back of your mind. On Thursday, August 31st, we're going to have worship at 7 p.m. here in the sanctuary. And then we are not going to meet again until September 10th. We're going to basically, all of us, do different things on the Labor Day weekend. So that's what's happening there. We are, Outreach is asking for donations for the stand down event that are due on September 3rd. If you look at the back of your bulletin, you will see more information about the stand down event, and there is a list of items that they are looking for donations for. All the clothing needs to be new. They're not accepting gently used. If you do have gently used, we can probably find a home for it somewhere else. There is a dehumidifier in the basement that is running its little heart out, trying to get ahead of the humidity down there. If you are in the church during the week and can empty the bucket, that would be awesome. It would be a blessing to the church. Other announcements.
Our next take-home meal, which part of proceeds will go to the stand-out event, is going to be Thursday.
Thursday?
Yes, September 7th, because the part of posters are going to stand out of it, which is September 8th, which is that Friday.
Got it. Thursday.
Okay.
And
it's going to be mac and cheese with bacon.
Mac and cheese with bacon. Okay. You can try to limit that, but I don't know how well that limitation is going to work. I think you disappeared to help us with coffee hour and then realized none of us were coming down. Are we still on coffee hour for today? Yes, we are. Other announcements? All right. Let us join together in my version of this week's take on Psalm 105. Give thanks to God for all that God has done, because God has always been there, in the middle of things, in the middle of danger, or bringing danger to the middle. Whatever is needed to protect the hungry and the oppressed, remember what God has done. Remember.
Remember what God has done, because God's works create a life.
So remember what God has done for God's children through time. Remember.
We need God's chosen. We need to be a service to the world. We need chosen.
Egypt was a place of refuge at first, though we have forgotten that. Joseph arrived there as a slave and his life was saved. As his power grew, his policies allowed the rich years to see not only the Egyptians, but the chosen ones through the famine times. Remember. About what had really happened to Joseph. And we left Jacob mourning for Joseph because of a charade that mocked reality. But the chapter ends in another place. The chapter ends in Egypt. Joseph is not dead, though he is not free. The dream is not dead, although it is hard to see how it is going to come to fruition, since Joseph is now enslaved in the heart of empire. So before we go out into this coming week, let me ask this. What dreams are dreamed over you? What promise is coming forth? What role are you playing? Of Joseph dreaming the dream? Of the brothers denying the dream? Of the father keeping the dream in your heart? All three. Can you remember that even as Joseph begins life in Egypt as a slave, God has not abandoned Joseph's dream, and God will not abandon